Hello everyone, the topic of today's discussion is adenomatoid or ontogenic tumor. We'll be covering the topic under the following headings. Starting with the introduction, odontogenic tumors are derived from the remnants of tooth-forming apparatus. That is, these are the tumors which have their origin from the apparatus which forms the tooth. So depending on the stage of tooth development, either it is cap stage, bell stage or bud stage, the pathological process will strike and the lesion can be predicted that it belongs to which stage of the odontogenic apparatus. Starting with the histological classification of odontogenic tumors, in 2005, WHO classified odontogenic tumors into benign and malignant categories. The benign category was further subdivided into odontogenic epithelium without odontogenic ectomesenchyme, odontogenic epithelium with odontogenic ectomesenchyme with or without dental heart tissue formation, and odontogenic ectomesenchyme with or without including odontogenic epithelium. So the adenomatoid odontogenic tumor in 2005 was categorized under the category of odontogenic epithelium with odontogenic ectomesenchyme with or without dental heart tissue formation. The other category was malignant, which was further subdivided into odontogenic carcinomas and odontogenic sarcomas. In 2017, WHO reclassified the tumors into two broad categories, benign and malignant. The benign was simplified into three broad categories: the tumor which are from epithelial origin, which have their origin from the mesenchyme, and the third category is the mixed origin, in which there is epithelial mesenchymal interactions. So the adenomatoid odontogenic tumor in 2017 been reclassified into the category of benign odontogenic tumors of epithelial origin. Starting with adenomatoid odontogenic tumor, this is an uncommon odontogenic tumor originating from the odontogenic epithelium. Out of all the odontogenic tumor, 3 to 7% of the cases are AOT or adenomatoid odontogenic tumor. It is the third most common odontogenic tumor after odontoma and amyloblastoma. And the most common location is anterior maxilla. However, there are controversies whether to consider it as a true neoplasm or it is an hematometric malformation. Seeing the clinical features, usually the cases belong to the younger age group and there is slight female predilection. The most common site is the maxilla, and in the maxilla, the most common location is the canine lesion. The clinical presentation of the lesions are usually asymptomatic. They are slow growing. Most lesions are central, that is the intraosseous type. However, some cases of peripheral variety can also be seen. The central lesion usually are associated with the impacted tooth and they resemble to that of dentigerous cyst in their clinical and the radiological presentation. Also, these follicular cysts are found in resemblance to that of dentigerous cyst and they are associated with impacted tooth. The adenomatoid odontogenic tumor is also known as two-third tumor because the two-third of the cases are found in maxilla, out of which two-third of the cases are seen in the anterior maxilla, out of which two-third cases in the anterior maxilla are found in the canine region, and two-third of the cases are found in young females. Two-third of the cases are associated with unerupted impacted teeth, and the two-third of the cases occur in the second and third decade of life. Therefore, AOT is also known as two-third tumor. When we see the radiographic presentation, mostly they are well-defined. Sometimes they can be diffuse unilocular radiolucencies. Sometimes they may appear mixed radiopaque radiolucent, and there can be presence of snowflake calcifications. Other features which can be seen in the radiography can be bone expansion and displacement of teeth. Sometimes there can be resorption of root, which is usually rare. Based on the clinical and the radiological findings, AOT can be further subclassified into two broad categories, the central variant, that is the intraosseous variety, and the peripheral or the extraosseous variety. The central variety has two further subtypes, the follicular, which resemble to that of dentigerous cyst, and the extrafollicular type, which is not associated with impacted tooth, and they resemble to that of globulomaxillary cyst and little periodontal cyst. The schematic presentation of the follicular and extrafollicular variety, in which we can appreciate that the follicular variety is found to be associated with impacted tooth and the extrafollicular variety can be seen away from the tooth. The follicular variant originates from the remnants of ventrella minor, which are seen in the gubernacular canal. The extra follicular variant develops from the remnants, which are situated in the periphery of the canal, in which the erupting tooth bypasses the developing tumor. And the peripheral variant develops from the remnants, which are residing in the gingiva. Coming on to the pathogenesis, when we see the odontogenic tumors, it has been said that they recapitulate dental ontogeny. That means the complex epithelial-mesenchymal interaction which takes place during the tooth development are found similar in cases of odontogenic tumors. However, there is failed induction or there is abortive enamel formation. So, the tooth development is not completed up to the stages of enamel formation. In 1992, WHO classified odontogenic tumor and they have said that AOT is the tumor which consists of odontogenic epithelium with odontogenic ectomesenchyme with or without dental hard tissue formation. However, AOT shows varying degrees of inductive changes in the connective tissue. Now it has been suggested that this AOT is not a true neoplasm, rather it is an hematomatous malformation. And the dental hard tissue which has been found in this tumor is not because of induction. It is because of the metaplastically produced mineralization. So the pathogenesis of AOT can take its histogenetic origin either from reduced enamel epithelium or from the cell rest of serrae, that is the rest of ventrella minor, which are residing in the gubernacular canal, or from the enamel organ and from the stratum intermedium. Those tumor which takes its origin from reduced enamel epithelium, they are found to have inductive capacity. So they will give rise to AOT of neoplastic nature. Whereas those tumor which takes their origin from rest of ventrella minor or from the gubernacular dentis will give rise to hematomatous type of AOT. Philipson et al. Also gave the concept of the role of gubernacular dentis in the development of AOT. This gubernacular dentis is a bony crypt which lies between the lingual crypt of the primary and the permanent tooth. So whenever the permanent tooth follicle develops into the gubernacular dentis, there will be development of follicular variety of AOT. And if it bypasses the gubernacular dentis, then it will give rise to the extra follicular variety of AOT. The follicular variety of AOT initially in the clinical and the radiological presentation resembles to that of dentigerous cyst. Therefore, AOT is also considered to be a master of disguise or perfect imitator of dentigerous cyst because of its clinical and radiological resemblance to that of dentigerous cyst. Now, coming on to the macroscopic appearance of AOT, it is found to be associated with an impacted tooth into the cystic cavity where there is a lumen which shows nodular proliferations and it is surrounded by an epithelium. In the histopathology, the most striking pattern of AOT is the presence of solid nodules of spindle shape and cuboidal cells, which will give rise to formation of rosette-like areas with minimal connective tissue stroma. The tumor cells is found to be arranged in varied histopathological patterns. In some areas, there can be ductal and scrotal areas. Some areas will show convoluted bands which will form rosettes. Other areas may form cribriform areas. The ductal and the subductal areas will show duct which shows single layer of palisaded layer in which the cells are cuboidal to low columnar, in which the nuclei are arranged away from the lumen. The lumen may be empty or it may have some eosinophilic material and this ducts will show variable sizes. The other area shows solid nodules of spindle or cuboidal cells which are arranged to form rosettes. These rosettes in the center can have homogeneous eosinophilic material. Other areas also exhibit presence of eosinophilic globules and tumor droplets. There are presence of row of tall columnar cell which resembles to that of pre-ameloblast and these eosinophilic globules can be failed induction. And these eosinophilic globular masses or tumor droplets can be some metaplastic calcifications which can be scattered throughout the tumor mass. These eosinophilic masses which are seen in HNE can be dental matrix material. They can be degenerative tumor cells. They can be basement membrane like material, or they can be some dystrophic calcifications. So they cannot be ruled out in HNE. So special stains are required to rule out their presence. So the duct lining cells resembles pre-amyloblasts. Thus the areas of ducts which shows these stains can depict failed induction or abortive enamel formation. Therefore, the pseudoductal areas which are lined by this amorphous material can be the areas of failed induction. The tumor cells in the rosettes are separated from the adjacent tumor cells by basal lamina-like zone. Therefore, the areas which shows the past positivity in the rosettes can be basement membrane-like material. The other areas in which tumor droplets and eosinophilic globular masses can be appreciated, these areas represent dental matrix material. They can be dystrophic calcification or they can be uncalcified amorphous material. Coming on to the treatment and the prognosis, AOT is usually benign because of its capsule. It can be easily enucleated from the bone. The tumor has not been documented to be aggressive and recurrence after enucleation is rare. To summarize, adenomatoid odontogenic tumor, it is a controversy whether to consider it as a true neoplasm or it is hematoma. It is known as two-thirds of tumor because of two-thirds of the cases are seen in females, two-thirds of the cases are seen in maxilla, out of which two-thirds of the cases are seen in the anterior maxilla, in which two-thirds of the cases are found in the canine region. Usually, clinically, it is asymptomatic swelling. It is slow growing. It has two varieties, the central or the intraosseous variety and the extraosseous or the peripheral variety. In the central variety, we have further sub two variants, the follicular and the extrafollicular. The histogenetic sources for AOT can be reduced enamel epithelium, restodental lamina, enamel organ and stratum intermedium. In the gross appearance, we can appreciate the nodal proliferation in the lumen associated with the impacted tooth in the cystic cavity. In the histopathology, some areas may show nodules of spindle cuboidal cell forming rosette. Also, there can be presence of tubular and duct-like spaces, which may be empty or may be filled with eosinophilic material. There can be plexiform or cribriform areas of spindle-shaped cells. And in the tumor areas, you can appreciate calcified amorphous materials. Also, AOT is considered as a hematoma because of the following reasons: the limited size, lack of recurrence, and because of metastatic mineralization. The first and the second are the clinical parameters to evaluate, and the third is the histological parameter. So AOT is a true neoplasm or hematoma is still a controversy. Thank you.